Rising up out of sprawling ranch land in North Texas, there's two giant new buildings.
The first one in the distance is an operating clean room. The one closer to us is the second factory that today is a shell.
And they're just the start of Texas Instruments' $60 billion seven-plant project, officially announced in July.
Yeah, this site long-term will produce hundreds of millions of chips every day.
Texas Instruments is making a big bet that companies will want to make a lot of chips on U.S. soil. And in August, Apple made a big new commitment to do, in part, just that. Amidst Trump's new promise of a 100% tariff on chips from companies that are not making in the U.S.
Apple is leading the creation of an end-to-end silicon supply chain right here in America. In Texas, we're working with manufacturers like Texas Instruments, Global Wafers America, and Applied Materials.
Apple has committed to making critical foundational chips for iPhones and other devices at TI's new fabs, and to supporting tool installations to make it happen, something we got to see in action in Sherman, Texas.
We are the first ever media to get inside this massive factory in North Texas. The whole campus is going to be bigger than 70 football fields or two Empire State Buildings laid side by side.
Though Texas Instruments doesn't make the world's most advanced chips, championed by the likes of TSMC and Samsung, its essential components are everywhere, in smartphones, cars, and data centers powering generative AI, with big customers like Nvidia, Ford, Medtronic, and SpaceX. Still, in July, TI shares plummeted amidst tariff concerns after its latest earnings report, although they've bounced back some since.
The worry is their end customers, like in the wake of tariff uncertainty, they don't know what to expect. Are they stockpiling?
Which has some asking, will future demand be strong enough for TI's huge spend to pay off? It's building four fabs here in Sherman, one outside Dallas, and two in Lehi, Utah.
We would have more than 5x of the capacity that we have today when all of these fabs build out.
5x is a lot. Do you think the market is going to need all that?
Yeah, when you think about the semiconductor content growth, it continues to grow.
We went to Sherman for this never-before-seen look inside Texas Instruments' newest fab, and to ask top leaders why, despite tariffs and decreased market share, this huge investment makes sense now. When we first visited the Sherman Fab, SM1, 2 years ago, it was just a concrete shell.
We're standing under the waffle table. That's what it's commonly called. So it's a clean room up top. The air comes through.
Now it's fully built. So we had to gown up in bunny suits to enter the operational fab, protecting the ultra-precise chip-making process from our hair and skin particles.
So as the wafers come out of the little box, they're going into a very clean environment within each tool. There's over 15 miles of this automated track.
Mike Haggerty has been with TI for 16 years. He showed us different tools and steps in the chip-making process.
The equipment in this room is called CMP, for chemical mechanical polish.
SM1 is currently in qualification, testing everything out before entering full production by the end of the year.
These tools are how our design become a reality on a wafer.
And how many wafers are going through here, like let's say in the 10 minutes we've been standing here?
These tools are very fast. They're processing hundreds of wafers every hour.
TI was originally founded in 1930 as Geophysical Service Incorporated for oil exploration and later military electronics. In 1951, it was reimagined by four Dallas engineers and given its new name, Texas Instruments.
Texas Instruments is not just the company that makes your graphing calculators. It's actually responsible for the first ever integrated circuit more than 60 years ago.
While TI does still make its ubiquitous graphing calculators, its defining moment came in 1958 when TI engineer Jack Kilby filed the first patent for an integrated circuit. It paved the way for miniaturizing chips by building all the components of a circuit, not just the transistors, directly into a single piece of silicon.
And it's helped spawn really a pretty large industry and the electronics that we carry today.
With TI for 24 years, Muhammad Yunus now runs technology development and global manufacturing. Unlike the costly bleeding-edge 2 and 3 nanometer chips being pioneered by TSMC and Samsung, Yunus says TI's core business, analog and embedded chips, are made on cheaper legacy nodes, 45 to 130 nanometer.
Which we believe is the sweet spot for analog and embedded because they provide the right performance, the power, the voltage that our portfolio needs.
Analog chips process signals from the real world, like sound, light, and pressure. Think the temperature on a thermostat or voltage on power management chips that keep electronics safe when plugged in. Embedded chips, TI's other major silicon product, are signal processors and microcontrollers for operating everyday devices, like telling the toaster to ding, the dishwasher to end a cycle, or anti-lock brakes to engage. TI sells the majority of its chips to industrial and automotive customers.
We tore down a Tesla Model 3, and to my surprise, they had among the most, if not the most, content of any chip supplier in the car.
That's the foundational nature of the products that we build. We have over 100,000 customers and about 80,000 different products. We say that if you have anything that plugs into the wall or has a battery in it or has a cord in it, you probably carry more than one TI chip in it.
Another pioneering moment came in 2009 when TI opened the world's first 300-millimeter fab for analog chips, repurposing a memory fab after DRAM maker Qimonda went bankrupt in the financial crisis.
And people were like, wow, they're making this lagging edge technology on leading edge 300 millimeter fab. But that's what really was the catalyst for TI to have such a cost advantage.
Yeah, 300 millimeter wafer has about 2.3 times more chips in it versus a 200 millimeter wafer. And you know, you get tremendous cost efficiency.
Have other analog companies followed suit and now make on 300 millimeter compared to 200?
There are a few, I would say, but there are very few companies who design, develop the technology, and manufacture semiconductor, the whole value chain, that do it in 300 millimeter and at the scale that we do today.
TI has been closing and selling off some of its 200 millimeter fabs, making way for the 300 millimeter wafers that all seven new fabs will pump out.
They win. Not because they have like 100% share of any one thing. It's that they are the one who, you know, opens their jacket like, hey, I have this. I can offer you all this stuff, right? And like, nobody else can do that.
TI says it's the country's biggest analog and embedded semiconductor manufacturer. It sells tens of billions of chips each year, but they're cheap, especially compared to the CPUs and GPUs sold by giants like Nvidia.
Nvidia sells one GPU for, you know, $35,000, and they're selling a part for, you know, 40 cents.
TI's affordable chips do play critical supporting roles for AI. In a new partnership with Nvidia, for example, TI is developing a new type of chip to drive efficiency in power-hungry data centers.
The amount of chips that go around the GPU to power it and, you know, the signal chain chips that go around it, there are quite a few of them in an AI system.
But in 2020, it was the auto and industrial industries that suffered when TI was hit hard by the chip shortage, unable to keep up with customer demand.
Everyone was like yelling and screaming about TI and saying, look, you're the poster child. I have to shut down my factory because I can't get your 40 cent part. TI's market share of analog industry revenue fell off a cliff. And their response has been, we're going to go out and we're going to build a bunch of factories. We're going to make sure that capacity is never going to cause us a problem.
Then came tariffs. In July, TI shares plunged over concerns about what tariffs mean for demand, although they have bounced back some since.
Is there a pull forward of demand, trying to get purchases in front of potential tariffs? And I do think we're seeing some of that. It's one reason I've been a little more lukewarm on the broader analog space.
But not everyone is concerned.
I would position them as more of a tariff winner than a tariff loser. If you're one of TI's competitors and you're using a foundry, let's say, and the foundry probably is in Taiwan, that chip is going to be more expensive than the same chip that TI will make because TI is making it in the US.
But despite its name and about 75% of CapEx here in the US, Texas Instruments is not only making chips domestically. It also makes chips at four fabs abroad in Germany, Japan, and China, and does testing and assembly in Mexico, Taiwan, the Philippines, and Malaysia, where it's spending some $3 billion on two new sites, one of which is now in production. As for international sales, about 60% of revenue actually comes from customers based outside the US. China alone accounts for 20%, which exposes TI to geopolitical tensions and tariffs China is imposing on US goods.
They have some wafer fab capacity actually in China, so they can offset some of that.
Tariffs is a dynamic situation right now. Our global footprint and our manufacturing across 15 different sites provides us the position to be able to support our customers no matter where they are and in any political or economic environment.
In fact, going international was a real possibility when TI was selecting the site for this massive expansion. The decision came down to two very different options, Singapore and Sherman, Texas, a small city 60 miles north of Dallas.
We are the hub of the Silicon Prairie.
Sherman, with some 50,000 people, is also home to a global wafers factory. The Taiwan-based company makes those bare silicon wafers that chips, including TIs, are made on.
When choosing between doing this project overseas or here in this community, the independence that it gives this country and also the independence it gives Texas Instruments to have their products sourced here locally is huge.
Sean Tiemann became mayor in November. His family landed in the area two generations ago when his grandfather worked alongside Jack Kilby at TI.
He holds 78 patents in the semiconductor industry.
And this isn't TI's first time making chips in Sherman. It built a 150-millimeter fab here in 1966. When TI announced plans to close it in 2020, the local government worked on incentives to entice TI to stay.
We were able to offset some of their tax liabilities and also help them with some water rate discounts.
Now Highway 75 has been expanded, downtown has new businesses, summer concerts, and a growing population. As for federal support, TI got $1.6 billion of CHIPS Act funding, plus a whopping 35% investment tax credit. That's an increase within Trump's big bill for those breaking ground on fabs before the end of 2026. At the state level, Governor Greg Abbott has long offered incentives to chip companies willing to build here, from low taxes to the $1.4 billion Texas CHIPS Act passed in 2023.
Because we have ports, because we have access to materials, because of our low-cost no business, we are best situated to lead this next generation of chip manufacturing.
Samsung is the other chip giant in Texas since 1996. It's building a $17 billion advanced chip fab near Austin, where Apple, Amazon, and AMD design many of their chips. Other chip makers in Texas include Infineon, NXP, X-Fab, Micron, Global Foundries, and tool supplier Applied Materials. But why Sherman?
We have the resources like water and electricity here locally that most cities don't have across Texas or anywhere else, really.
Indeed, making chips takes a lot of power and water, and both have a history of being scarce in Texas.
The semiconductor industry here in our community, and largely driven by Texas Instruments, almost doubles the amount of water that our city was using.
When this factory is fully built out, we would use about, 1,700 gallons per minute.
TI's immediate target is to recycle at least 50% of that.
And, potentially achieve up to 80% water recycled rate in this facility.
Texas is hot, with about a quarter of the state in drought. But in Sherman, there's Lake Texoma.
We treat our own water, we pull it from Lake Texoma, and we have water rights, which most communities don't have.
Chip manufacturing is also a power-hungry process.
By some estimates, we're going to run out of power by 2030. What's your plan?
This 300-millimeter manufacturing actually drives energy efficiency. You use pretty much the same amount of energy, but produce 2.3x more chip. But also, I'm really proud to say that this factory, when it's in production, 100% of the energy is renewable.
Texas's uniquely independent grid largely cuts it off from borrowing power across state lines. In 2021, that grid failed during an extreme winter storm, causing at least 57 deaths. And halting production at chip makers like Samsung and NXP, although TI says it maintained critical operations.
We built redundancy into this facility. We have multiple transmission lines that feed power into the site. We also have large diesel storage tanks and generators that can continue to power the site for a few days.
It also helps that Sherman has a power plant in town, which recently increased capacity. Highly skilled chip engineers are another scarce resource, a talent pipeline that's been stymied by the dramatic decline of U.S. global semiconductor manufacturing share over the last three decades.
Analog engineers are pretty sparse to begin with, so there's a lot of younger people moving to the area. I actually think it's going to be easier for them to get the talent now than it would have been 5 to 10 years ago.
With the full $60 billion project, TI says it will create 60,000 U.S. jobs.
We partner with universities to develop engineers, but we also partner with the military, with skilled workforce development to develop the right kind of talent that we need as we continue to grow here.
As for whether this massive increase in CapEx is too much?
They're making a big bet on the fact that they regain share and that demand comes rocketing back. If you don't regain that share, it's hard to justify building this much capacity.
Back in Sherman, we got a sneak peek into the shell of SM2.
And then long term, all four factories on this site will be connected together with one clean room, one overhead track.
TI wouldn't divulge a target completion date, but it does plan to make a lot more chips on U.S. soil one day.
Can you share anything specific about timing?
No, it's hard to predict when exactly that will take off. You know, we're hopeful that we'll continue to build out at a pretty brisk pace, but it really depends on the market.